What is all this stuff here you got, JJ? What is this weird looking can thing with a hole on it?
So this is the overflow can, and what we use this for is to capture displaced fluid. So the can is filled with soapy water to this spout level here. And so if we put anything or we submerge anything down in the fluid, it's going to displace some out into this beaker here, and we're going to catch it in that beaker.
So if we put this whole cylinder in, then the volume of the water that goes into this beaker would equal the volume of the cylinder.
That's correct. Yeah.
Now, what if we wanted to know the mass of that water?
So what we're going to do in this experiment is we're going to measure a few things. And one of them is the mass of the displaced water. And so I've got a balance here that we're going to first put the beaker on. And I'm going to actually do that right now so we can use that beaker.
So you could either record the mass of the beaker, which is about 50 grams, or...
Right. What we're going to do is we're going to put the beaker on here, and then we're going to tear this or zero it and then take it off. And although the scale reads a negative value right now, if we put fluid in the beaker and then put it back on, it's going to tell us... It subtracts out automatically the mass of this beaker.
So we have to do less math that way.
Yes, that's right.
Okay. So that's why you want to do it.
That's right. So the balance is going to tell us the mass of the fluid that gets displaced.
Now, why are we hanging the cylinder from a smart cart?
What we're going to do in this experiment is we're going to submerge this metal cylinder, right? And we're going to measure the tension in the string here that from the weight of the cylinder. And we're suspecting that tension is going to change as we submerge it because of a buoyant force. And we're trying to see how that change happens depending on how much of the cylinder is submerged and how much water gets displaced. And so we're going to measure the force of tension here while also comparing the weight or the mass of the water that gets displaced. And then we're going to use that to calculate the weight of the water.
So the... upward force of tension, you're saying, is going to go down as we submerge it, and the amount it goes down is the buoyant force.
That's right. So right now, the force sensor is measuring the tension, and that tension is due to the weight of this brass cylinder.
Okay.
And so as we submerge it, the measurement that this sensor is making, the tension is going to change. Well, we suspect it'll change, and that change will be that... force
from the buoyancy. So I need to record what the tension is. Right now it's 2.01. We should make sure it's zero when that's not on it.
So in this experiment, one of the first things we want to do is make sure we zero our force sensor. Well, nothing's there.
It's zero.
Okay, so we're pretty good there. And so, again, I'll let go. And that tension that it's measuring is the weight of that brass cylinder.
So I'll enter that.
Yeah, and so that value on the right side of your screen, that's a live reading from the sensor, and that tells you the tension in the string.
Now, it says here in the data table, we're going to submerge it 1/4 its length.
Yes. So in the experiment, we're going to collect 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 data points. One when it's not submerged at all.
We have that.
Yeah, one when it's a quarter, one when it's half submerged, when the half of the length of it is submerged. 3/4 and then completely submerged.
So we'll need to know that total length. And so I'll enter that in the data table as the depth when the whole thing is submerged. And so each one of these cylinders is 6.5 centimeters. So I'll enter that because you will need to know that.
Yeah, and so what I've done here and what the experiment has you do is you take your cylinders, and these two cylinders are identical in terms of their geometry. And then you measure and mark the cylinder in quarter sections. So there's 3 marks on the cylinder indicating 1/4, half, 3/4, and then obviously if it's fully submerged.
I can see this one has the same thing, so that will help with the data collection.
Right. And so we're going to go down in stages, first with none of it submerged, 1/4, half, 3/4, and then fully.
Now, it looks like this might be tilted a little. Is that going to cause a problem?
Yeah. So we want to make sure that this cylinder... hanging from the sensor is hanging straight up and down because the volume that we're going to submerge is part of this experiment.
It'll be easier to calculate.
Right. And so
again, less math.
Yes. Right. So if we submerge a cylinder straight up and down, we know that we can easily figure out what that volume is.
Okay. Let's do it.
Okay. So we've zeroed the balance. The water level is at the right height. So when we submerge this, fluid will displace and go into that beaker. I think we're ready. Okay, so yeah, no mass has been displaced now. So I'm gonna loosen this and then lower it down until a quarter of the cylinder is submerged.
Yep, water's coming out.
All right, and I'll just lock that in. Yeah, and this dripping can take a while. So we might speed things up a little bit in this video just to help because we're gonna do this three more times.
Okay.
Okay, so the dripping has slowed down quite a bit, and you know the drips just get further and further apart. And once they get far enough apart, and what did you say, once every 15 seconds
yeah.
or so, then that's probably good enough.
There's one more coming out. I'd say if you can measure the mass of the water before the next drip comes out, then it's probably good.
Okay, so I'm gonna take this, put it on our balance, and it reads 5.26 grams.
Okay. Enter that. And then the tension definitely went down. It's fluctuating between 1.96 and 7. And, or at least it was.
Okay.
And now we're ready for submerging it halfway.
Right. So I'm gonna loosen that. And there's halfway.
And
the dripping commences again. Okay, so again, the dripping has slowed quite a bit. We'll maybe wait for one more drop and then make our mass measurement real quick and record our tension value. And
yes. Sometimes you can speed it up by tapping it a little bit, but you don't want to upset it if you want accurate data.
Right.
That's good.
Okay. So I'm going to put this on the balance, 11.24 grams.
Okay. That makes sense. It's a little more than double the other one. And then we have 1.9 tension.
Yep.
And okay. We're ready for 3/4.
All right, 3/4. And the dripping goes again. Okay, so we'll let this drip go in and then maybe one more, and then we'll go ahead and measure the mass. There we go, that'll get that out there. All right, once, as soon as it drips, we'll go ahead and take it. And boop. This mass is 16.76.
Okay, I've got that entered. And the tension is 1.84.
All right.
And now we're ready for 3/4. I mean, all the way.
Fully submerged.
3/4.
All right. Okay, dripping is slowed again, one about every 15, maybe actually more than 15 seconds. We'll wait for this last drop to go in, and then we'll take this last data point for the cylinder. And drip. The mass is 23.95.
Okay, and the tension, 1.77. And so the remaining things in this data table include figuring out the volume that's submerged. So now the entire thing is submerged and you know its length and it's a cylinder. but you also would need to know the radius.
Correct.
And so we're going to tell you the radius here. There's not a place in the data table. The radius of the cylinder is 1.17 centimeters. So you need to know that to be able to figure out the volume.
Right. And then once you know the volume of the whole cylinder, it's just some easy math to figure out what the volume is when you had a quarter of it, a half of it, and three quarters right. of it submerged. And then we're going to repeat this experiment using the aluminum cylinder, and we're going to follow the exact same procedure. So we're just going to provide the data that we collected for that separately. It'll be in with the brass cylinder data when you go into the file.
So aluminum cylinder, what would be different about that? It's still metal. Why would we do that?
That's correct. The densities of the two metals are different.
Oh.
Right?
So I wonder what would that mean the tension would go down more or less?
Well, that's what we find out in the experiment. So okay. Observe your data and answer the analysis questions accordingly.